Wow. Hi, my name is Marcus, and so the way I typically go about giving talks is I try to be as casual as possible, just because I'm not great at being formal, and I'm also not great at slides. So instead of slides, I created a repo, and all the things I'm going to be going over is on the different readmes of the different directories. So if you guys do have a computer and want to follow along, it's simple enough to just go to the GitHub page. My username is crazycom. I've had it for a very long time. Crazycom, drop a Y. It was a Yahoo generated name back in the day. And then the repo name is Python Go Hello to the World. Give you guys a few moments. All right, so a quick overview of what I'm going to be going over today. I have this introduction. I'm going to go over Hello World in both Python and Go. Just in general, we're covering both things in both programming languages, Python and Go. And I'll be writing a number of programs and going over how I went about them and different ways of looking up documentation for them, because I really like documentation. We're going to start off with the canonical Hello World. Then we're going to move on to building up functions and using functions to say hello for us. And then we're going to start venturing into saying hello to our friends and how we go about doing that. And then we're going to try to beef up our intelligence of our friends and make them human beings. From there, we're going to try to not build our friends each and every time. Maybe use some JSON to use that data to build our friends for us. And after that, I'll go over a little bit of resources that I've used or came across. Sound good?
Yeah.
Yay! Oh, at any point in the time, if you have a question, you can raise your hand or let me know, and we could stop and just chat about it. Informal, remember that. all right, let me close this web browser. I had it open here as well. So I'll be opening my terminal a lot, and we're going to need to adjust it so it's the right height and the right size. Tell me, is this big enough? Okay, make a few more of those. Dun, dun, dun. And like I said, it's all online, so we can go into the Hello World repo real quick. And since I'm more familiar with Python, I'm going to start with Python first. Go is a language that I'm learning as well, so this was a learning experience for me when in writing this. Hello world in Python. One line. Print, then there's a string. I'm sure a lot of people have seen this. This is one of the selling points for Python. It's really simple. You can write hello world in just one line. There's not much to say here. You just print this to screen. And let me run that for you real quick. Python. Hello world, pi. What does it do?
Hello world!
All right, let's look at the Go one. It's a little beefier. So in Go, we have a little bit of boilerplate. Everybody can see this, right? Okay. Every file in Go has a package. And for an executable file, you still have to have a package name. And that package name is going to be main. And in Go, you don't have to have imports, but in order to print to the screen, you have to use at least one import. And that import is called FMT. It's used for formatting for a number of things like strings and buffer IO and scanning input and output, and even formatting errors. So then you create your function. So in an executable file, the main function is what's being called. It just does this behind the scenes. Anytime you call a Go file, main just starts getting ran. And in this function body, we have fmt.println hello world. This time I added an exclamation point. So we can see the general syntax of a function. We have the naming syntax, func. We have the function name. We have a place where we can pass parameters if we wanted to. After it will come the return, which we'll see later, because main is just pretty plain. All right. So let's go over a few things now that we've seen those files. The Hello World Pi, beautifully simple. No imports, no packages, just built-ins. Print to screen. Hello World Go. It's still simple, but there's some boilerplate. Like I mentioned, each file has a package, and this one called is a special one called main. It defines a standalone executable, not a library. All of Go's functions, like I said earlier, FMT allow you to print the screen. That's for all your formatting. And we created a function. I just want to make sure I covered all my points. Oh, so some of the cool parts of Go, and I added some cool parts throughout the presentation, is that the way Go does encapsulation, or private versus public, is via capital letters. So earlier we saw FMT dot print line, where print was capitalized. That means it can be exported. So when you're reading a Go file, if you see something is capitalized, it can be exported. If you see something is lowercase, you can't touch it.
So that eliminates the access modifiers, like in Java, instead of writing public, void, or whatever, you just define the function based on capitalization.
Yeah, I thought it was clever. All right.
So that's only the first letter, though, right?
The first letter, yes.
So it doesn't matter if you have like all caps versus like funky camel case or anything, right?
Not that I know of. I believe it's just the first letter. And in terms of convention, things in Go are written in camel case. All right, let's exit out of that one. So we saw the Hello World. So let's beef it up a little. Let's go to Hello Functions. All right. Hello Funk, the way I wrote it here. Oh, I didn't run the Hello World for you guys. Let me go back real quick. So in Go, there's a number of ways to use it. I used Go Version Manager, which allows me to download different versions of Go. And the most recent one is Go 1.7. So I'm gonna switch to that real quick. Go 1.7. And let me clear this and make it up higher. To run a Go program, we use Go, Run, Hello, Go. What do you guys think this is going to do?
Whoa.
Dun, 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 dun. Hey! Hello World, you were right. You forgot the exclamation point, though.
That was compiling.
Why did it take so long?
Oh, so when you do run, you are compiling each and every time. However, there are other options. If you wanted to compile it once and then have a binary that you want to call, you have that option as well. So you can skip the compile time.
That was a pretty long compile time.
Yeah.
It's a compile time. Yeah, there's something else going on. It's got like a virtual machine.
It's just the first one.
I'm not exactly sure, but that's something we can look into. If anybody else knows, be willing to answer.
All right. You ran this without compiling into a binary, right?
Correct. Hello Functions is next, right? Here you go. All right, so we're going to look at the Python first. So what we see here is some syntax. In Python, when you want to define a function, we have this nice little word, def. And then you have a space, you have this one, hello. No parameters. And then we have this is a colon, right? Semicolon has a comma at the bottom. Colon. And then we have these four spaces. Well, typically four spaces, just spacing. So Python, in general, defines its scope, the function body, by using spaces. And then similar to what we had in the Hello World, we did print. We have print Hello World. And then I have these slash end, which just give us new lines. Little spacing. So let's scroll down a little bit. Here we have something similar. We have the def. We have the function name. This one I called one param. And if you notice, I'm using underscores. From my understanding, this is more of the Python way of name conventions. We use underscores instead of camel case. And then I'm passing in a param. there's nothing next to it. It just says name. So we don't know if it's a string or anything. We just know that it's passing. It's taking a parameter. And then when it comes in, I'm doing something a little fancy here. I have print hello. Then I have this little icon, this brackets, and then new lines. And then I have a dot format name. So in Python, one of the conventional ways to go about formatting your strings is to use this dot format notation. There are a number of ways to go about formatting them, but since this one is really, really powerful, I decided to use this one throughout the presentation, and it's the one I like. So what this is going to do, was that a question, a statement? Oh,
Is that a method call on a character string?
It is, actually. Well, it's string of characters, but yes, it is a method call. So we have this string, and the string has a method called format, and we're passing in the parameter name, right? And name is going to get substituted to this location, and then we're going to see hello name. But you don't have to believe me on that. When we run it, we check my work. All right, and the next one, we have something similar, but I'm doing two parameters. Def, name, two parameters, format, everything's pretty much the same. All right, but this one's a little bit different. Dun, dun, dun. So this one, I said def, hello, list of names. Well, Python has a number of different data structures. One is called a list. Think of it similar to an array in other languages, but you can have many different types in it. It's not restricted by that means. So it's a nice little container. We can pass things in and then find things by index if you like. And one of the ways of iterating over a list, the canonical way, is for loops. So I was very descriptive here. I said list of names. So I can imagine that this list is composed of names. For name in list of names will iterate over this list and give me each of these names one by one so that I can use them. And as you see at the end of here, we have this colon and we have another space, defining the scope of the for. And then we have everything we saw before, the hello, format, passing the parameter. So it's going to do that for every name in the list. All right, still with me? Well, that's not the, oh.
Yes, so where is the list defined? You write list underscore of underscore names.
Mm-hmm.
Is this a data type?
This is just the name of the parameter that I'm passing in. So the list, actually, I haven't shown you. That was a really good question. I haven't shown you anywhere with a define yet. We're getting to that. There's something special at the bottom that I really like in Python.
Also, one question. Spaces. I'm new to Python. I always found it confusing. How do you just use a tab, or how does it, like, it has to be two spaces, three spaces?
He's a good editor.
How do you keep track of
spaces?
Of the spaces and not to lose your scope?
So Python is very lenient when it comes to that. However, there are a number of ways you can try to manage it. In your editor, you can set your tabs to spaces. I try to set mine to 4. And then anytime you hit tab, it goes over exactly 4 spaces. So that when you're writing your code and somebody else views it in another editor, they will see the same type of spacing. And there's also other programs, like Python Standard Library, which is humongous, comes with something called Tab Nanny. That will go through your file if you want it, and then check to see, make sure you have the correct number of tabs.
So a single, so if you want a single white space, can define your scope.
If you're consistent with it, I believe it works. I've seen people do it with 2.
There's no magic in a number of spaces as long as you use them consistently. So
yeah,
you
within a block, it's looking for uniform
within a block. So it's intelligent enough to recognize if throughout the function.
It thinks you're indenting them. So if you have an extra space, it's going to go underneath the function. If you miss the space, then you're.
Just explain how it works on the board.
Haskell's function is true in Haskell.
Just explain how it works on the board.
Haskell's function.
Haskell's function
is
got to be in the first column.
It's.
All right, just to go over a little review of what we just did. So we were talking about scope and how Python deals with scope. So let's look at the hello list again. We have the function, and then we have the scope, the body of the function, indented into for, right? And then we have this for loop and has another indentation. So this for loop also has its own space, its scope space, which is then defined here. It's still within the scope of the function list, but now everything for this for loop is going to happen in this body. Once that body is out, once we come out of it, this is lined up with the for loop. This means this is no longer in the for loop scope. I hope that was clear, but if it wasn't, I'm sorry. Okay.
Because the variables you define in that scope are still visible outside that scope. So if you define, if you say like x equals y inside of the for loop, when you go outside the for loop, that x will still be defined and it's still equal to, you know, phi or whatever sort of sign.
Well, it will be the last variable that comes out of the loop, right? Just like in any loop.
Mm-hmm.
So you use the space, you use the indentation and the colon instead of the like curly brackets, basically.
Yeah.
Right.
Correct.
Optimization.
And it looks sleek. All right. So the next one, hello list two. I wanted to show you two ways of going about this. So define function. We have the name. We have the parameter, list of names, same thing as before. What's different is now I'm writing string of names, and I'm using a string and calling a method on it called join. Now, what join allows you to do is take an iterable and then join them together. So here we're taking the list of names. I'll explain this part in just a second. We're taking the list of names, and we're seeing, oh, here's the first name. All right, let's join that with the second name. Let's join that with the third name. But what do we want to join them by? And that's where this comes in. So each name is going to be separated with a comma and a space, just to make it a little bit more realistic. Now, here we go to the slicing of the list. So there are different ways to get the objects or the items you want out of this list. And Python has this nice little syntax. Here I have nothing here. I have a colon and I have a minus one. The nothing, depending on where you start from. In this scenario, it means the very beginning. I could have wrote zero, but negative one means the second to last item in the list. It's a nice little convention, so you don't have to remember know the length of it. You can just say negative one and it goes to the second to last. Oh, that's where I'm messing up. So I don't believe this is inclusive, but we're going to have to double check my work. Because the goal of this, when you write a sentence saying hello and a bunch of names and you have this and, I'm just trying to say correct in terms of English. I don't want the last name to be repeated twice, because that's kind of awkward. I don't want to say hello, Marcus, hello, Jane, and Jane. So I'm trying to split that up, but let's see if I did that correctly. Thank you. Double checking. Keep doing this.
Help two, but not including the last.
Like you said, I'm going to reiterate that so everybody can hear. This is up two, but not including the last element. So this negative one actually points to the last element. Earlier, I was wrong. My apologies.
Technically speaking, does negative one point at the last element or in between elements? Point to the boundary or the actual element?
Mm.
Some language is different.
I'm not exactly sure what the difference is.
Documentation kind of implies that the boundary is not a place. I wrote an answer about that on Stack Overflow about slicing, where I basically changed the paradigm a little bit by moving this. And say basically that means up to but not including the last.
So this is like an equivalent of go up to the length of the list, basically.
Yes.
The full length of the list.
Mm-hmm.
And you start with zero.
Yes.
Which is omitted.
Yes.
Okay.
Glad you're getting it. All right, so we have the print statement. And we have the string, and then we have the dot format like we saw earlier. I'm passing two variables in now. I'm passing the string of names, which was up here, already declared and formatted. This should include the last element, the last name. And then I'm passing in the very last name, which is list of names, minus one. And hopefully that's to give you hello, name, 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 comma, and last name. Well, not last name, but the person name of the last person. You guys know what I'm talking about.
Last name in the
list. Say it again? The
last name in the list.
Yes, last name in the list. With these last two, I was going over some of the ways of unpacking. What I mean by unpacking is that in Python, we saw earlier where we can pass in a one parameter, we can pass in two parameters. We saw earlier we're passing a list. I actually haven't passed these lists in, they're down here. We'll get into that shortly. But there are other ways to go about doing it. So if we wanted to pass in a bunch of names, but we did not want to pass in a list per se, we just wanted to throw the names individually, but we didn't want to say name one, comma, name two, comma, name three, comma, we can write this asterisk and a star. And everything that gets passed in will be put into a list, which then we can iterate over. And instead of rewriting the code that we did where we looked at this list of names and then we dealt with it appropriately, I just called these functions hello list one, which, let me scroll back up a little bit, which is this one. And in the second one, I called hello list two, which is this one. Now we're going to go to the, oh.
So the asterisk means you're passing a list, basically,
right? It means it will get interpreted as a list. It will get put into a list, and then we use it as if it were a list.
Okay. How do you pass in an arbitrary number?
So if you put an asterisk in front of a variable, it understands that this is a container. This is a list container. Mm-hmm.
It's vaguely like
bars. All right, so this is Python magic that I really like. We have this if underscore underscore name underscore underscore double equals quotes underscore underscore main underscore underscore quotes, and then we have a colon, and then we have this nice indentation, nice little line here. What this does, I explain it a little bit more in detail, but from my understanding, what this does is that when you call a file in Python and you want to run some code immediately when it's ran and not have it cluttered up here, you can put it down here within this scope and it will run for you. However, when you import this file, this stuff will not get ran at all. So there's an issue that some people can run into. I've ran into it once or twice, where I write a file, I want to test some things out, so I put some print lines and I put some calling the variable so I can see everything that's going on. But then when I import that file in another file, that same stuff comes out to the screen and I don't want it there. One way to deal with that, ta-da! If, there's a lot of underscores, but this syntax. And this is where I define all the variables that I was talking about earlier that we didn't really get to see. So we have name one, Marcus. Hi, I'm Marcus. We have name two. That is my girlfriend. She couldn't be here with us tonight. She had other engagements. She actually flew out to India to get a yoga teaching certificate. And I'm sort of jealous. She's off of work for a month. But yeah, Giovanna couldn't make it. we have a friend of mine, David, who is married to Lily. And then we have our list of names, which I just put the names again. Marcus, Giovanna, David, Lily. It's kind of like a double date. And then I'm going through just calling the functions. We had hello with no parameters and just prints, I believe, hello world. We have the one parameter where I pass in name one. Pass in two names, name one and name two. Hello list, list of names, double date. Pass in there. And then, remember before when I was saying the star is an asterisk? I just pass in the names, one, two, three, four. probably should have rearranged them a little bit, but I don't want to date Lillian. I don't think David wants to date Giovanna, so that could, that, I think this is fine. All right, so I'm gonna run this file and let's see what it does, because we gotta check my work. No. Python. Let's clear it first to make it nice and visual. You guys ready for this?
That number is fast.
Wow.
Yeah.
What's the difference?
So we have the first one that was called Hello World. Then we have Hello Marcus. Hi, I'm Marcus. We have Hello Marcus and Giovanna. That's what happens when we go out together. Oh, we have the first Hello List, right? Where we're just going through the for loop. Hello Marcus, that was the first name that was passed. Hello Giovanna, that was the second name that was in the list. Hello David, the third name that was in the list. Hello Lily, she's last, but she's a really nice person. And then here's the Hello List when we used the join, which it looks like I did it properly. David is not repeated twice. I was kind of afraid of that. So the list had these people in it. We did a join with the comma, so we had the comma in the space, and then we had that last element, which was the list of names, and then the brackets. Or how do you, what are these called?
Square brackets.
Square, got it. Square brackets, and inside we had a negative one, which pointed to the last person on the list, Lily. And then here is where we did the passing of the asterisk in the name. So we passed all four names in, name one, name two, name three, name four. And then we pass that into this function again. So it's identical, which I believe it should be. And we did the same thing with this one. All right. That's going pretty well. Let's see what any talking points I had over for, well, not Hello Resources, that one's way too soon. Dun, dun, dun. There's multiple of these, and they're all called README. Oh, here we go, Hello Functions. So, like I said before with the basic syntax, we have the, can everybody see this? Okay, cool. We have basic syntax, we have the def, function name, parameter one, comma, dot, 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 parameter, n. Python uses space instead of brackets to define. It may not be fair to call it scope, but I did write scope, my apologies. And oh, one thing I didn't show is that a function can return one or multiple values. I say one or multiple because even if you do not return something, it's still returning something. And what it's returning is a variable called none. Sort of weird, but a lot of scripting languages do this. You kind of get used to it. Ah, that is a good question. So one way it can return multiple values, actually I haven't showed you anything where it's returned yet, so thank you for asking, is, oh, let me just open something and then we can just write it real quick. Ooh, I'm thinking of the wrong language. Tab, spaces. Four. We can return, let's say, one and then separate it by commas. And this returns something called a tuple, which is very similar to a list, except it's immutable. Immutable meaning that you cannot alter it once it's been formed. And then you would interact with these return items the same way you did with a list. You can iterate over them, you can call them by index. There are some examples of this later on, but I haven't showed them any now.
So it really returns one data type, right? In a sense.
Yeah.
It doesn't actually have multiple values.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you for that.
It's funny how parentheses and commas are important. You have to be careful sometimes. You can put parentheses around it and have the same. Unless it's a different skill.
All right. Ooh. So I have a little section on formatting strings. I already mentioned there's a number of ways of going about it, and that the format is a method on string. What I'm about to show you, though, is top secret in the Python world. Don't tell anybody. It's called the interactive help. And we got to remember this. String methods and formatting. Can somebody help me remember that? Thank you. So I'm going to type in Python. We're in the interactive interpreter. And then I'm going to type in help, and I'm going to call it with zero arguments, right? And then we're brought to this world of helpfulness. I'm going to read this out loud so you guys can get how helpful and useful this is. If this is your first time using Python, you should definitely check out our tutorial on the internet at enter URL. Enter the name of any module, keyword, or topic to get help on writing Python programs and using Python modules. To quit this help utility and return to the interpreter, just type quit. To get a list of all available modules, keywords, symbols, or topics, type modules, keywords, symbols, or topics. Each module also comes with one-line summary of what it does. To list the modules whose name or summary contains a given string, such as spam, type modules spam. All right, now we're going to go into topics. They told us to type topics, right? And Python tells us a list, gives us a list of topics that we can look at. And what were the two that we're supposed to look at?
String methods and formatting.
All right, one thing to note is that these are all in capitalized, so we have to capitalize ours. So string methods, I think I typed that correctly. And then we're brought to this documentation that's really explicit about what you can do with strings. Now, I'm not going to go over all of this. I just wanted to make sure you guys know of these things, but we have, just scroll down real fast, we have string capitalization, or capitalize, case fold, and in these you can see that it gives you a description of what it does, returns a copy of a string with this first character capitalized, and the rest lowercase. Interesting. Center, encode, and from here you can get a sense of what you can do with strings. And the great part about this is that you don't need the internet for this. I do most of my programming on the train. I wrote most of this presentation while on the train, and because of that, I tried to stick to my guns when it comes to documentation and being it localized on my computer. All right, so let's get out of that. I think there was actually, you did remember the second one. What was the next one I had to look at?
Formatting.
So we were using just the basics of what formatting can do. It's really powerful. It has a bunch of different syntax. You can pass in iterable items. You can pass in these little terms to tell you how much spacing you want to take up. You can change the order. You can call dictionary objects by property name. It's kind of crazy. And it's all given here. Like, you can see some of this. We use this and this, but we can actually just pass in the variable name, and it knows which one to pick out and put there. And we haven't gotten to anything that uses dots yet or zeros, but we can do that as well. It's pretty powerful when it comes to formatting. And if you ever have the need to format your strings, you should look at string format and see what it can do for you before you maybe try to. Yeah. That's another option as well, but they might tell you to go here. If they don't, tell him. All right, get out of that real quick. Make sure I covered everything. Ooh, we have a list. So I did mention what a list was. It's a mutable sequence, typically used to store collections of homogeneous items. It doesn't have to be, but that's just a typical use case for it. And we have an immutable sequence, which is tuples, which I briefly mentioned. Now, there's documentation on both lists and tuples, but most of the documentation I found that was more informative was in tuples, where they explain both what a tuple is and what a list is and the sequence. Let me just open that real quick just so you get a sense of how good this help is capitalized. Python help.
Is there an upper bound on tuple size?
I am not sure.
No. Memory.
Ah, yes, memory. So I believe it was in tuples again, but let's just make sure. And tuples is right there. Tuples. Let's scroll down a little bit. So they give you examples of how to use things. Like we can do in and true if the item S is equal to. Okay, some of the syntax is a little confusing. You have to get used to it. But in essence, it's just telling you whether X is in the tuple or list S. And immutable sequences. They have the list of all the basic methods here and examples of how to use them. Dun, 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 and they go over what a list is. And as you can tell, this is where I got my sentence from. I didn't trust myself to write a very descriptive, correct, and accurate one line for what a list was. So I stole it from them. And this is stuff you can read later on, but I just want you to know it's here. All right. Oh, so some cool points. What I mentioned earlier about this is called when you execute a file, but it's not called when you import one. Said that. One thing I didn't know about Python when I was going over this presentation was that you can actually define a .main file, and then when you execute the Python will look for that file and execute everything in there. So you don't necessarily have to do this whole thing. You can just create another file and it will run that. I thought it was kind of cool.
It runs that when you load anything within that module. Within that directory, if you load any module within that directory, it runs the main.util.
I think that's pretty cool. People don't really tell you that.
It can also, you have to be very careful what you put in there, because it's supposed to like secretly run. So if you do things that, like, you know, go to the internet and load something, you'll find it executing at bizarre times. So.
When it's being loaded as a module. When you're saying when it's being loaded as a module, it will just...
When any module within that directory is loaded, then all the .double underscore names above it are...
I think you mean thunder and this.
It's a pretty dress case.
Yeah.
All right. All right, so let's move on to the Go side of things. Oh, that's capitalized still. Clear. All right. So we're back to a Go file. Like I said in the first one, we have a package. We're going to call it main because we like uniqueness. We have some imports. Last time I did an import where it's just a string name. But you also have the option of using these parentheses. And then putting your strings inside of them are the things you're going to import. In this one, I import FMT, which we're familiar with, and something called strings, which, ironically enough, deals with strings. I think it's going to work out. So I try to be careful to try to make everything similar to the Python, so we write the same thing side by side and have a look at it. So we have the hello, like we did in the last one. No parameters. And all we're doing is printing hello world. We have hello one param. Notice I did camel case. Camel case is when you have one word and then the next word starts with a capital letter and then the next word after it, if there is a next word after it, starts with a capital letter. We can see that the function, when we pass in a parameter, takes this nice little thing called a type. This one is string. So we know that when we're passing in name has to be of type string. That's pretty useful. And then here, this is something a little bit different. Earlier we used fmt.println. Now we're doing printf. And I like to think of the f as format. So the way you format strings is the basic formatting in Go is you have the string and then you have this little symbol. There can be many different versions of it depending on what you were trying to print, what type you're trying to print. But in terms of strings, it's this parentheses sign and then an s. And then we have the rest of the string, comma, and then after the comma, we have the parameters that we want to pass into this to be formatted. And this one is just name. So name we know is a string, and it jumps in there.
What happens if you have this mesh?
Say that again?
I mean, if name you say the int type, what will happen?
Then it won't compile. And then Go will just yell at us saying that we did something wrong, most likely that this is string and not int. Compiled language doesn't mean like that.
but it's finger up, Go.
Pascal.
Alright, be nice. So the next one, we have two parameters, right? And here we did right after the name. In Go, you have the option of, if there are multiple parameters with the same type, you can put the parameter, comma parameter, at the very end of the parameters with the same type, you can write string, or the type it's going to be. And they will all have to be strings. And if you pass in, it won't compile. Yes?
What if you only want one of them to be a string? What if you only want the second one?
So if you only want the second one to be a string, then you can still use this format. It'll be name one, string, comma, you only want the second one to be a string. Name one, int, comma, name two, string. Okay. And then you have one of type int and one of type string.
So it's a sequence followed by the type.
Yes. And then we do something similar. We have the format, we have the print f, and then we have the parenthesis s and parenthesis s. Same thing we did in Python, just syntax is a little bit different. But it's about the same size. All right. So now we have this list of names things. And I call this hello slice. So in the last one in Python, I said hello list. Because the data type for Python, we typically call it a list. And other languages might be called something else. In Go, they have something very similar. And it's called a slice. They also have arrays as well. However, they're not used all that often because, slices are just easier to work with. The syntax for a slice, or the type, is you have the name, list of names, camel case. We have the square brackets, I learned this earlier, square brackets, and then we have the type that everything's going to be in there, which is going to be a string. One thing that I mentioned in Python is that the items in a list can be of different types. However, in Go, they all have to be the same type. And it's specified as string. So if you try to put a string and an int, it's not going to compile. And yes?
So in Go, a list is more like an array. If they have to be the same type, right?
Yes.
Not all arrays require you to have elements of the same type.
Right.
But does Go have some kind of like a root type, like any type?
Yeah.
They do. It's called the empty interface. And it's pretty much empty. It's just a struct with nothing in it.
You create an array, a list of that interface, that type, you could have
instance string. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's one way to work around it, yeah.
And we're just think of the arrays. Arrays are bounded, whereas the list should technically be unbounded.
Yeah, arrays and lists aren't very comparable, actually. Very different.
Yeah.
One thing that's pretty interesting in Go is that the slice points to underlying arrays and different slices depending on how it works out. Like, this is stuff I read, so I haven't actually went in and then tried to figure out exactly what it's doing. But you can have slices that point to different points of arrays, and you can have different slices that point to the same points of the same array. And because of this sort of I don't want to say this not confusing, but this complexity, you cannot directly compare slices in Go. But you can directly compare arrays, and arrays are hashable.
So, quick question. Are those pointers, or are those like actual objects?
This is an actual object, but the underlying data structure has a pointer that points to something else.
Most languages don't ever pass actual objects, because that means that you're copying the object every time you want to pass it.
Right. Yeah.
and you can also pass
the reference by value.
Yeah,
that's usually what they say, is that they pass that reference by value.
All right. So another thing we're going to go over, iterating over slices, not lists, slices in Go. We have a for, like we did in Python, but we have some different stuff here. We have an underscore, comma, name, this little symbol, range, and then the slice. Now I'm going to explain some of this. This thing within this context and a number of other contexts allows you to declare different variables without explicitly stating their type. So range allows you to iterate over this item. This item is a slice of strings. So this, like we had in the list, we have the first item, like to say zero, index zero, there's a name, index one, there's a name, Marcus, Giovanna, David, Lily. So I wrote name here, but what is this? This is the index, and in Go, they have this really cool feature that I really like, is that if you do not use something, if you declare something and you do not use it, your code will not compile. It'll tell you you did not use this. And if you want to avoid that, you make it an underscore, and then Go is like, okay, I understand you're not going to use this, and we're good, we're good. You can run this code. So that's why we have an underscore here. By convention, but this is enforced by the compiler. Say that again?
With Python, if you structure a tuple, it'll have the same an error when it happens at runtime. So it'll say that this tuple doesn't have an element.
Yeah. Can you repeat that one more time? Sorry, can somebody else explain it as well? I'm
basically saying that instead of a compile time, you're going to get the error at runtime.
Oh, when you're unpacking variables?
You unpack the tuple, yes.
Ah, yes, if you want to in Python, when you're unpacking a tuple, I haven't covered unpacking, but that's when you have, let's say a list or a tuple has, let's see, three elements in it, right? And you want to define three elements, three unique elements without iterating over it. Then you can do, this is this way, you can have A, comma, B, comma, C equals the tuple that has three elements, and then they'll get unpacked to first, second, and third. A, B, C.
But if you want to ignore the third element, you can put an underscore.
And if you want to ignore the third element, like he said, you can put an underscore. It works. It's fun. Thank you. I was trying to figure out which way you guys were viewing it, then I remembered it this way. So
it's a great way to explain things. Interpretive dance.
Side note, if you ever want to learn algorithms, there's a bunch of dances online, like the Hungarian dance. They're amazing, and they explain like merge sort, and it's beautiful.
Yeah.
YouTube has amazing resources to memorize algorithms just by watching people dance.
Oh my god.
Like, you can see, like, they have like, oh, this is, these are algorithms by audio cues. This is how sorting an algorithm sounds like. This is a merge sort sounds. Mm. They're like, oh, this is what a merge sort sounds like. Oh, this is what it looks like we play with blocks, and there is some really good stuff.
YouTube is amazing. I agree. All right, so we did the, I explained the for, and now we have brackets. We have to mention the brackets. Scope, which I might be using wrong, but I'm going to use it because I'm used to it, is defined by the brackets. Here we have the for loop. We have this bracket, right? And then within it, we have the something we're familiar with, the print format. We have the name being passed in, and we're just iterating over the items in this slice. Same thing we did earlier. Nothing too complicated.
And you're using scope correctly.
Say it again?
You're using scope correctly.
Well, I think in Python, there's scope and there's bodies.
Yeah,
and all the bodies are in the same scope. Right? But I don't know about Go. Go might be structured more traditionally, where a nested body is in the scope.
Oh, okay, I see what you mean.
Because the variable in Python leaks out of the body.
Oh.
Unless it's defined in something that defines the scope.
Then it'll be a closure?
One loop is joining. Yeah.
All right. So scroll down a little bit more. We did the join in Python, so I figure it'll be all right to do the join in Go. So same basic structure, func, name, list of names, slice. All right, I explained what this was earlier. When you wanted to declare a variable, but you don't want to explicitly say the type, and it infers the type from whatever's on the other side, that is the right, left-hand side. So we have the, we're doing the same thing we did in Python. I just want to get out of the project, the light was hitting me in the eye. We want to get everybody but the last person in this slice. And one way of going about that is slice, square brackets, we have it open again, so it's going to start at 0, nice. And then we can use length of the names, of the length of the slice minus 1, which will give us everything but the last one. And then the thing that we're joining by, unlike Python, gets put at the very end. Here we go.
That syntax, that slice syntax, that's also the same as Python's explicit slice syntax. It's just the other one is a shorthand.
Yeah.
It's, in Python, you just ignore the length of, you just put the number that you want to put. That minus 1, you just put the minus 1 in there.
He had that in words.
Yeah. So that syntax actually works in Python as well.
Nice. And then we have the print, which we saw. Same thing as we did. Hello, S, string, which we have strings here. This was strings.join. It returned a string. And then we have the last item. That's kind of far down there. I'm not going to walk all the way. Which is going to come here.
Oh. What is this comma?
Which one?
Again, the comma at the end. Up there.
This one?
Yeah.
Oh, so like we had earlier, we have this slice, which is similar to a list of different names. Name 1, name 2, name 3, name 4. And we want to join all these names to make a string, but we want to separate it by something.
So it's a separator?
Yes.
You're just passing the separator as a second argument.
So it's going to be, the end result should be name 1, comma, name 2, comma.
You're specifying the separator.
Yes.
And Python has that sort of substitution as well with the percent S's. You put a percent at the end and then a double and go to the substitution.
It also has the F, right, in something. I forgot what it was. They do have like a print F for formatting.
I think that's what that percent syntax is. I think it uses it.
It's a shorthand for
with that.
Yes,
even the print syntax. Yeah.
Print formatting. Yeah. But the percent itself, you put the string percent and then the parameters. That's shorthand.
Yeah. So the next part, we have this function, and we have this ... string. So what this ... means is that we can pass in n number of parameters in. Like we were doing in Python, we used the star thing. Same exact idea. And all of these items are going to be of type string. And I'm passing them to hello slice. So what this does, similar to Python, is it puts them into a slice, which is similar to a list, and then we can use them accordingly. And instead of rewriting the code, I pass them to hello slice. And I did the same thing here for hello slice too, so we can see it again. Just mimicking the code, mirroring it. And I pointed out pointers, but this is the only time you're gonna see pointers in this presentation. I don't use them all that well, and I don't know how to use them all that well. Still learning. But if you wanted to pass in a pointer to a string, you would be using this syntax, where it's name, star, asterisk to star.
People say both.
Okay.
Star is easier.
Star asterisk star. String. And that will, then you can pass in a pointer to a string. One thing that is different when you're formatting it is that you can use other terms. This one is V. I believe this one is for value. So it's going to print out the value of the pointer to the string, this name.
So if you put in percent S there, you want to actually get the string, you would get the value
pointer? If you put in S, I believe it doesn't compile. But it's touchy, this compiler thing.
So how would you get the value of the pointer value then? The pointer address, yeah.
This does point out the pointer address, but we'll see shortly when I run it. And I did the same thing here with two parameters, as you can see it again. And then I define the main function, which has the names. Ooh, I put different people in this time. Okay. We have Marcus. We have Alan. Alan's my middle name. I was running out of ideas. We have Willock. That's actually my last name. We have Giovanna, which you guys have not met because she's not here. I let her know. We have Evelyn, which is not her middle name, just another friend of mine.
Okay.
We have Christy, which is another friend of mine.
Does Giovanna know?
Oh, yeah. These are my friends from, I've known Giovanna since high school. I've known Evelyn since high school. I've known Christy in college, and I met T.Y. through Christy post-college. So just my life in a line.
In a list.
And then we have the pointers. So some of the syntax of pointing to a string, or defining what a pointer is using this, I want to call it an and symbol.
Ampersand.
Ampersand, name one. So this is pointing to the value of name one. And this is pointing to, yes?
Well, I was just curious why you're having the need to resort to pointers.
I just put them in so you know of them, because Go has pointers, and if I didn't touch on pointers at all, people might think I'm a little iffy.
Okay.
So here is a slice literal, I believe the correct term is. We have we're defining the slice, we're declaring it. We have the slice, the square brackets, string, name 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, that's a lot of people. And then now I'm just calling the functions explicitly. One parameter, two parameter, nameless, one parameter, two parameter, and then the pointer ones. I was pretty explicit in the naming. Name one pointer, name two pointer. And now let's run it just to make sure it does everything I said it was going to do. That was much faster than the hello world. I just want to point that out.
What happened?
I don't know. I got to call up some people after this presentation. Let them know the differences.
Probably the compiler itself.
Or the OS cache.
Compiler not cached.
Run it again.
Yeah.
Run it again.
Run it again? Okay, let me clear it real quick. Ready, set.
So it's like made. It's already made. You didn't make it again.
Hmm?
You didn't change the file, right?
I didn't.
And that's why.
You
didn't recompile it.
Can you run it? Just run it. Touch the file and then.
Yeah, touch the file and then run.
Let me clear. Just hit touch in the file, right?
Is it like Python where there's a compiled version on the file system? Like a PYC?
Do it.
Or a GO?
Just do it.
Not that I know, but you can. Oh, you can create the binary.
Yeah.
Oh, that's fast.
The actual compiler takes
up
as a huge
file.
It's fast.
By the way, that's why.
You can go back to Hello World and see how fast it is.
Yeah.
Say it again.
You got the pointer addresses rather than the address of the string rather than the.
That was intentional.
That was intentional, yeah.
Okay.
But they have a nice little.
So that's what the percent V did?
Say it again?
That's what the percent V did?
Yes. So as we see, we have the, let me scroll up a little bit because I think we're missing the Hello Marcus, or Hello World, that's where it started. Hello World, Hello Marcus, same basic format, just a lot more people, feeling the same person. We have the hello with the joining of the string. Passing two parameters? Oh, this is the slice. Actually, no. I'm not exactly sure which one that is.
I think it's the one where that takes n parameters.
N parameters? I think you're right. And there's two that take n parameters, and they were right next to each other, and they had the same input. And then we have the pointers at the very bottom.
Hexadecimal?
Run goes hello world from the beginning again. We want to see if it's fast.
The very first one you ran.
If you guys want it, I'll run it.
Yeah, please.
Yes. All right, let's go back then.
Jamie's warming up.
She's warming.
All right, let's clear. Go run. Hello world. Ready?
Yeah.
3, 2, 1.
It's your computer.
So probably you should reboot the computer. Slow again.
Reboot.
Where does it store the compiled version?
I don't think it's a question of storing the compiled version. I think it's a question of compiler reading it from disk. Reading the actual compiler already from disk.
Yeah, okay. The first time you called the compiler, it had the load.
Right.
Now it's in
recognition. Yeah, the last cached in.
So the compiler itself needs to be loaded.
So yeah,
okay.
That makes sense. It's much like an interpreter would have to be loaded. But once you've loaded it, then it kicks in.
Okay. But I think Python's interpreter is much smaller and it loads it more easily.
Okay. Let's go that. I went over the function signature, I believe that's the correct term, of how Go is. Function name, parameter, type 1, parameter n, type n. You can do returns similar to the way in Python, you can have multiple returns. Return A, I used A instead of 1 because they don't necessarily have to be correlated. Return A, type A, return Z, type Z. And then the function body. Returning from a function is optional. I do not, and in Python we had the none was, there was always at least none that was returned. In Go, I don't believe that is the case. In Go, I think if you don't want to return anything, you have that right. And you can return more than one. The variable declaration, there are a number of ways to do it. The way to do that is the outside of a function body, you have to use the var name type equals express, and you cannot use the shorthand that I showed you earlier. So you have to know both. However, the shorthand does save you a lot of typing. But you can use this within the function body if you wanted to. That's completely your right.
Does that define the variable globally, or does that, it's just locally?
It's locally, it does the same thing. I mentioned pointers because they exist. I don't really know that much about them, but I do have a link to a tutorial that's on the Golang website tour. If you want to go learn more about pointers, that might be a good place to start, at least in terms of Go. Cool points, I mentioned everything you import or declare, you have to use, or else the program's not going to compile. The compiler will tell you no. It likes telling you no. Oh, go run versus go build. So I told you about building binaries, but the actual way to do that is instead of using run, you say go build, and that will compile the program and create a binary that you can just call directly, and you no longer have to compile it again. And you just distribute that binary to people. All right. So the next one. Hello friends. Let's open the Python. So in Hello Friends, my goal was to try to get a little bit more sophisticated. We were saying hello to names, and we were saying hello to something that was predefined and clear, but in terms of an actual conversation or actual group, when you say hello to people, there are things you take into account. Whether they're a close friend to you, I might not say hello, I might just give you a hug or say what's up. Whether they're a stranger, I might take a step back, shake your hand politely. Depending on culture, you might give somebody a little kiss. And I try to incorporate at least a little bit of that. Oh, you also want to be clear of somebody's gender, too. I mean, I don't want to hug somebody for too long if they're uncomfortable with it. And so I try to be a little bit cautious of that in this one. So the first thing I'm doing here is I have a dumb function that prints things to screen. And what I wanted to do here was also bring in the concept of sort of validation checking within a function. So we know what a function is, and we know the basic syntax, and we're passing in a string list. It's a list of strings. But this thing here is called isInstance. And what this allows us to do is check to see if that thing that was passed in, that string of list, is actually a string of list. So I put string of list, and I want to check to see if it's a list. But if it's a tuple, it'll still run. The API for both of those lists and tuple are about the same. So if it's a tuple, I don't mind. So I said, if it's a list or a tuple, I like it. So isInstance is going to check to see if this instance is one of those types. And if it is, it will return true. And if it's not, it will return false. So if it's not one of those instances, I want to tell the person that is using my program, you're using it wrong. And to do that, to raise an error, to tell somebody you're doing something wrong in Python, or just to yell at somebody, you can just raise something. And I'm raising a type error. So Python has a number of errors that are built into the standard library that you can use, and type error is one of them. And when you call an error, we raise an error, you pass in a message, and that's the message the person's going to see. So I was pretty nice here, and I said, I received something, and I expected something else. So I did the dot format, and I said, I receive type, whatever this is, because it's not list or tuple, so I want to know what it is. Calling type on it, or passing it into type function, will return the type of whatever this is. And I was expecting one of these. I just want to let them know.
I think there's a shorthand for that whole thing that's built into Python.
All right.
I think it's like a cert type or something. I forget exactly what I'm using.
No, you don't want to use a cert.
But it's, well.
There's a flag that turns off a cert, except your code relies on that and someone runs your code with the flag.
I don't think it's a regular cert. Something a little more.
It's a test, but otherwise, no.
I think there's some
syntax. I promise
you.
I gave the last talk on Python here.
No. It's not a regular cert. It's
something else. We're going to table this until later. Go, Marcus.
Is there a try catch? Can we do a raise? Is there some sort of try catch around
there? Onward.
So you can use try catches. That is a part of Python. I typically don't like them because some people try and then they catch everything, and it can be a little iffy. So if they pass in what I want them to pass in, then I do the iteration over the list and I print out the string. Same thing we did earlier. All right, so let's go through some of these functions. In the function name, you can notice I put an underscore in front of it just to show that it's sort of private, as in you can call these, because in Python everything is more or less public, but I really don't want you to, not directly. Anyway, that's what it's there for. So I do close friend, I give them a hug.
Is that a convention or part of the language?
That is a convention.
But if there's two underscores, it typically means that it's part of the language itself. That's also by convention, but
yeah.
Like the language is, you know, if you put two underscores, like, it's fine.
So if somebody is not so close of a friend, I say, hey, but they're still a friend. I say, hey, how have you been? How are you doing? There are a lot of scenarios where I meet people and I have a horrible memory, so I don't remember them per se, but I remember them enough to know that I know of them. That's a general greeting I do. If you ever hear from me, my apologies, you know what it means now. Greeting a stranger, hi, my name is Marcus, very standard. Greeting a male, just in case. Some people like to do really firm handshakes. I just put this in there as a general stereotype. Giving a firm handshake while looking him in the eye. Bless you.
Thanks.
Greeting a female, doing a slight wave while telling the person my name.
You also did something interesting of
Say it again?
The implicit concatenation.
Oh, So in Python, there are a number of ways to join two strings. And one of the ways that I like to do it is having a parenthesis with multiple strings inside that parenthesis. And even if you go to new lines, what this is going to do is going to take the first string and all the strings following it and concatenate them, which means join the strings together. And then once that is done, if you want to, you can still use format on the string that is produced. It makes for a nice visually, because if this went all the way over there, it's hard to read in my screen. I work on a really small computer, a netbook, so I can't deal with long lines. This one's kind of long, but it fits in my netbook. This light wave. Then I created the main function, no underscore. This is what I want people to see. And it's called greet a person. If you notice here, I have these three apostrophe or quotations, and then another three down here. And this allows you to do multi-line comments in Python, and also allows you to do documentation. They go hand in hand. And when you write underneath a function name or a method name or something similar to that effect, then they come up as documentation strings. Oh, yeah. I use Nano for my editor. Don't judge me. We have name, and then we have people. People is a list. So I did type of friend, set it to none. This is just some general logic I'm going to go through really quickly. Gender, I put none initially because I want to declare these variables. Greetings, I put none. So if it comes through, People, I was wrong. People is a dictionary. I'm yelling at myself for thinking it was a list. If it is not a dictionary, tell them I don't want it. If name's not a string, tell them I don't want it. So let's go down. So if the name is in the dictionary, close friends, let me explain what dictionary is, just so everybody knows. It is I want to say a hash map, but that doesn't make it any clearer. So it is a mapping between a key and a value. And the keys, at least the ones I'm using, are strings. And these strings are going to point to a value. And the values that I'm pointing to are lists, list of people, or a list of names in this case. And one of the ways to get these values out of a dictionary is using the .get method. So what this is doing here is just saying if name is in the dictionary value of whatever this returns, this key returns, close friends, which is a list of my close friends, then we do what's in this if body, which is type of friend equals close friend. And I go through that general idea for this entire portion. Else if, which is Python syntax for using else if. I don't know how to pronounce that directly, but else if, it's just the one way you can say it. Think of it. Name is in people that not so close friends do the same thing. Else, I don't know this person, they're a stranger. And we do the same thing. We're going to add a bunch of different relationships there. We're going to add a bunch of different genders. And doing the same thing for gender. Gender unknown, which does happen at times. Sometimes you just don't know.
So that's non-binary.
Say again?
That is non-binary. You don't know what
their
gender is.
Yeah, because binary is two, right? Did somebody have a question?
So that's actually a perfect example of what I was saying, where the scope is not based on nesting, it's based on what function is defined.
Oh, because you can still use these outside.
Yeah, so the scope of gender is not if, but it's what else, everything else, it's the whole function.
All right, thank you. This is a good example of what you said earlier. Hope everybody remembers, so they don't use scope wrong. That's kind of bad. So here I have another set of logic. If the type of friend is a close friend, then I have greetings that append greet close friends. And the functions that I named, the private ones, the semi-private ones with the underscore, just return strings. And I'm putting those strings into a list. So one of the ways you can go about that is using append. So it's the list greetings that append will take whatever this is returning, this function is returning, and put it into the list. And people can be in multiple groups, so I'm just going through and just appending. So we have close friends, if they're a close friend, if they're a stranger, do this, if they're not so close friend, male, female, else, pass. Sometimes when I'm really, really confused, I just don't say hi to somebody. That is an option. You don't always have to say hi to people. And then I return the greeting. So down here, I did the same magic with the if and the name, and then I just started declaring things. And I will tell you who all these people are, but that'll take way too long. And I put them in categories. We have the list. We have, this is the dictionary syntax that I was going over earlier. So dictionary is people. We have the key, and then we have the value. Key, value, key, value. And these values are also defined here. They're references. So the key to close friends returns this list of people, list of names. And then I'm just passing these in. So we see this name, comma, dictionary. And we see what happens. So everybody got the gist of that real quick? All right, I'm going to run this, and let's see what happens. So, hello, friends. I hug Christy, close friend, always hug her. Julie, not so close with her, so I say, hey, Julie, how have you been? Somebody I don't know, unknown guy. Hi, unknown guy, my name is Marcus. He's a male, gave him a nice firm handshake, just in case if you wanted it, sometimes, just in case. Unknown girl, hi, my name is Marcus, slight wave. These are all the things that are appended to the greetings list, and then I just went through and just appended it to the greeting list. I'm not sure if I showed you, I got passed them to the dumb interface that prints things to screen. It just iterates over whatever's in the greeting list and then throws it out to the screen. And unknown. This person, I don't believe, has a gender. So I just said, hi, my name is Marcus. I didn't really do any action after that. I am. All right. How much time?
Let's go over the ghost stuff and then just wrap it up.
10:15.
Okay. So let's go over the ghost stuff. Let me clear this. Hello, go. So one thing you notice is the same thing at the top. We have the package, we have the imports. Those are typically at the top. I think they have to be at the top. The compiler will tell you no. We have the dumb interface for print to screen. What you notice here is that I didn't have to do any instance checking because the compiler would do that for me. So this is actually a little bit shorter than what the Python was.
I have a question. What is this underscore in front? What are you not using here?
This one?
It says that you're not using a variable. What are you not using here?
Anytime you iterate over a slice, it gives you the index, the index value of the location of that item, and it gives you the item itself. And I do not want to use the index, so I put an underscore there. And I wasn't sure what the...
So the index is... Okay, so which one is the index? So you're not using the index. You are faulting it, in a sense, saying that you're implicit, right?
If you're going to run an I, but the compiler complains you don't use it.
Yeah, it'll tell me no. Send me to my room, put me everything. I'll be grounded for a week. The compiler's mean.
Okay. It'd be like, why change out your toys and play with them, and now you just left the room.
Exactly.
So normally you need to have an index in the folder, but for that you need to declare it, right?
Say it again?
You need to use an index in the folder, and for that you need to declare it. You don't want to declare it, so you use shorthand, right?
More or less, because this is going to return two items regardless of what I do. And if I have to accept those two items appropriately. And if I accept those two items by giving it a name and do not use it, Go will yell at me. So I make it an underscore letting Go know that it's here, but I'm not going to use it at all.
Okay.
And in here we have string. So it's a bunch of strings in a slice. And then we're getting each string individually. And I'm just printing that to the screen. A dumb function, dumb interface. Here, I put all of these lowercase, just so you guys know they're private. Go, capitalize, lowercase. Went over this earlier. Nobody can use these but me. And then we have the same basic principles. So one thing that's different here is that and when you're messing around with strings and you want to format a string, you do fmt.sprintf. And then you start formatting strings, and it returns strings. And you can still use the same basic syntax. We have the string, and then you have the substitute variable, substitute symbol. And then you have the string that you're passing in. So it's all pretty similar to Python from this perspective, at least right now. Same thing with close, not so close friends. Greeting strangers, same basic principle. Greeting a male, firm handshake, looking in the eyes. Slight wave, telling her my name. And I have some comments in here. I wasn't exactly sure I was going to go about writing this the first time, so I thought to myself, I said, maybe rethink how I write this. Let's see if I rethought it. Comments can be stale. So we have the function greet a person. That is, we pass in a name, and then we pass in a, and we call it a map in Go, but it's a dictionary in Python, hash table, the key value thing that I explained earlier, same principle. Here we have map, we have the keys, which are all going to be strings, and then we have the values, which is going to be a slice. So we put the slice here, and then we tell you what type every item in the slice is going to be. And for simplicity, at least for what I wanted to do, I threw in two different maps, one for people and then one for genders. So this is the syntax I was talking about earlier when you want to declare a variable. Var name variable type. One thing in Go is when you declare a variable and you do not put an expression after it, what it's going to be equal to, it by default gets declared as the default for that variable. Which in strings is an empty string. If it's an integer, it will be zero. Anything that has a default set, it will be declared to that. Gender, greetings, all declared as defaults. So when you are iterating over a map, similar to what you do in Python, you have your keys and values. You have this same syntax, and you have range. I'm using both keys and values here, so there is no underscore. Now, values, as we know, is a slice. I want to iterate over that as well. So I'm having the same paradigm where I don't want to use the index of that when I iterate over, so I just want the value. Values, value, and value. Ta-da! And if name, which was passed in, of the name of the person, is equal to the value, which is the hash map of people, then I'm taking the key, which by convention, at least in the way I wrote it, is the relationship I have with that person. It could be close friend, not so close friend, stranger, and other things. And for simplicity, or just to get out of this area, I'm breaking out of the smaller loop. And so this is the if, this is the for loop I'm breaking out of, and then right here, which is still within this for loop, I'm saying if the type is not equal to zero, as in if it, I already figured out what the relationship is, I want to break out of the upper loop as well, just so I don't continue iterating over them. Boom. I did the same thing. I also did a check to see if it was still zero, then they're a stranger. I just wanted to make sure my strangers are identified. Then I did the same thing when it comes to gender, because it's also the hash map of the, it's also a map of the same data structure. So same thing, I'm checking. Name, key, see if they're in that list, and if so, I'm breaking. And then this is where it gets interesting. So in the Python version, we did the if type, close friends, and then we appended to that list. In Go, we append to the list as well. However, append is a built-in. So you do append the slice and the value, and that is going to add that item to the slice. We also have else if, but we spell it out completely, and we put a little space, so it's easy to read, I guess. And we go to the second relationship, and then the third. I'm just continuing that paradigm. And we do something very similar here. Male, female. I kind of skipped the case of stranger or unknown, but And then I send it to the dumb interface for printing the screen. So this is going to get called main. It's going to get called when I run it. And here's a list of everything. I'm not going to go over the names because relationships are complicated. But we have close friends and males, females, not so close, strangers. We're defining a map literal. So the way we go about that is we have map, the type of the key, the type of the value, and then we have these brackets, curly braces. We have the key and then the value, key and then the value, key and then the value. Do the same thing for people and genders. And I didn't do many examples here, but it worked the same as this does in Python. Greet a person, David, people and gender. Greet a person, unknown girl, people and genders. And now I'm going to run it. You guys ready for this? Is it going to be fast? Is it going to be slow?
It'll be fast.
3, 2, 1. Ooh, it did warm up.
Yeah.
So I hugged David because he's a lifelong friend of mine. Unknown girl, I said hi politely and told her my name. And did a slight wave while telling her my name again. I'm a little awkward. But in terms of the presentation, this is about all I have time to go over today. There is more in the GitHub repo where I start creating classes and using structs, and I do a little bit with JSON, and then I have some resources at the end. One thing that I don't think I went over, but I would like to go over really quickly, is some of the Go documentation that you can look at while writing your programs, or just get familiar with the environment. The tool is called GoDoc. Let me clear this so it goes to the top. GoDoc. What's annoying about this is that you have to know the package name in order to find anything. FMT is something we looked at all day today, so FMT. And what this does is it prints out all of the functions, everything that you can export and use from the FMT package, and tells you what the signature is. MD interface is what we mentioned slightly. That just means you can pass anything in. And then under the hood, FMT is going to figure out what it has to do with it. If you wanted to know what one of these does specifically, let's say print line, then we can do go.fmt.println, and it brings up the documentation just for that one, this case, function. And it tells us how to use it. So this is nice in that you can look up everything as long as you know the package. But if you don't know the package, you're not going to find anything.
What's the A dot 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 structure?
The dot 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 structure is... I'm not sure what they mean by the A. It could be that this is... A is the variable. You can throw in any amount of these N, and then dot 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 is the you can throw in N, and they all are interface, empty interface, which means you can throw in anything you want in there. So it could be that, but I'm not explicitly sure. An example of what happens when you don't know what the package is let's say you want to look up, I don't know, string, right?
Is it searching the whole internet now?
No, this is all local. All local to your computer. And it just tells you this. Exit status 1. Exit status 1. That's all it tells you. No help whatsoever. So,
I was going to ask, will the GVM give you different doc versions?
So the doc, Go doc is the tool that is with the version of Go that you're running. So if you're running a different version of Go, then it's potential that you'll get different versions of the documentation. However, Go tries to do their best to remain backwards compatible with every version of Go. So should it change too much, you might have more instead of less later on in the later versions of Go. Do you guys have any other questions of me right now? I answered all the questions in the presentation and there's none left. In that case, I'm going to say thank you for listening.